welcome to the second Wealthy Boomer interview with Bill Kanko, the Managing Director of Black Creek Investment Management, Inc. Welcome back, Bill.
Thanks, Sean.
So you told me you quite recently took a trip to China, partly business, partly pleasure. What did you discover?
Oh, it was a real eye-opener. We've been learning about China and hearing about China for a long time, number of years now, decades almost. But it was a real eye-opener in the sense that you can't think of China as one place. There's new China, old China, rich China, poor China. There's the developed coast and the interior where you still have water buffalo pulling carts. So you can't think of it as one coherent place. But an eye-opener in the sense of the development, the construction, and just the varying degrees of development and potential there.
Now, for the Global Leaders Fund that you manage or co-manage, is BRIC and China a part of that mandate, or do you have to sort of stretch it together?
Well, the emerging markets are part of the mandate, but this isn't intended to be an emerging markets fund, so you're never going to find half of the portfolio, for example, in emerging markets. We do own a few things in Brazil, some in Eastern Europe, some in Mexico. We don't own any companies at the moment directly in China. The companies we've been looking at are very highly priced. But we do have exposure to China in various degrees through some of the holdings we have. For example, Adidas is a co-leader in market share in sporting goods in China. Atlas Copco sells compressors, mining construction equipment in China. Intel is going to have huge growth potential in emerging or developing markets simply through the growth of personal computers. So we do get exposure, but not necessarily through Chinese companies.
Well, often people say that they're going to play China through like the commodities. That's the Canadian story. And yet you guys don't even own Canadian stocks in your fund. So that seems like a bit of a contradiction to me.
Well, I've historically not owned a lot of commodities. China right now is really taking market share of commodities and manufacturing. A lot of manufacturing that traditionally was done in Europe and North America has moved to China, less is being done here. So it's really a market share thing in China, as well as internal growth. Internal growth at the moment is being driven largely by government spending and very easy credit from the banks in China. So there's a bit of a construction boom going on there now, almost a bubble. And so there is demand for the commodities, but most of the commodities we look at, in particular oil, we're having a hard time figuring out why oil is at $75 a barrel and not lower, given the current global economic environment.
Okay, so I'm presuming that the lion's share of the portfolios are American and Europe.
Well, there's 21 holdings currently in Global Leaders Fund. Of that, 9 are U.S.-based. We have 3 in Japan, not because we want to be in Japan, it's those particular companies. What we really do is look through the companies to see where they're generating their sales and earnings. So the geographic diversification for us comes through where the companies themselves are doing business, not the simple pie chart that you might see in the typical global equity fund brochure.
What are those 3 Japan stocks?
We own a company called Hamamatsu Photonics. We own Makita, which makes power tools. And we own Murata Manufacturing.
None of the big, not Sony.
You don't typically recognize the names,
though. Yeah, exactly. And how about in America? How about any of the people are talking about tech stocks making a comeback? Any of those, the big Dow stocks?
I've probably owned more technology in the past year or two than I have in a long time. We own Intel, we own Oracle, we own Adobe Systems, we own some Applied Materials. And probably a couple others. So more technology orientation than in a long time.
And the same goes for in Europe?
Not so much Europe. We own in the international fund some SAP, some Taiwan Semiconductor. We also invest in technology in a backdoor sense. A lot of the companies we invest in use technology to gain market share and to gain competitive advantage. So it's not always your typical box maker technologies. It's sort of, you know, through the back door, I call it.
Now, in our first segment, we just talked briefly about moats and what you mean by
right.
A leader.
Right.
Maybe you can come up with an example here of a company that does have a moat that is a leader. I mean, I'd ask you about RIM, but apparently you guys don't like.
Well, we don't own RIM.
Any of those commodity-like plays. Yeah.
Right. Well, I mentioned Oracle and Intel, and particularly Intel is in a business that requires massive scale. They spend $6 billion a year on R&D, $6 billion a year on capital spending. That it just dwarfs their competitors, and it is a business of scale at the end of the day. And so Intel has this huge moat around it, and you can't just start up a microprocessor company.
Any other examples?
Oracle, in technology again. Oracle has the biggest market share of corporate databases, and they just run the must-have systems for big companies. And again, there are basically three, maybe four companies in the database, corporate database market. Oracle has the biggest market share, and their business model just provides for a steady and growing stream of cash flow over time.
So to close off, are you generally optimistic that the bottom was in March and that happy days are slowly coming back again?
Oh, I never call bottoms. I think that's a tough thing to do. We don't try to time markets. Our process hasn't changed over time, no matter what the environment is. We're simply out there trying to find the next idea, the next good idea, and put it in the portfolio and replace something that we don't like as much. So we spend very little time worrying about where the market's going to go.
Thank you very much, Bill Kanko of the Hartford Global Leaders Fund and Black Creek Investment Management.